members this evening sitting, Miles England, John Hensman, Kevin Haynes, myself as ex officio for the select board. Attending the meeting this evening is alternate Caroline Kendall, who is not a voting member this evening. But there she is.
Sorry, what date was the email? Because I have a agenda that's not the full draft.
We're going to start with that. We don't.
All right.
I'll look at it on my phone as we go. So first order of business, election of chair. Are there any nominations for chair of the Rollinsford Planning Board for 2018 into 2019?
I'll nominate Mr. England.
Miles England's been nominated. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by John Hensman, nominated by Kevin Haynes, sorry. Are there any other nominations? Seeing none, we'll close nominations. All those in favor of Miles England serving as chair of the Rollinsford Select Board, say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, okay, say no. Congratulations.
I wanted to not give any, that not for any discussion.
Congratulations. Thank you, Miles. Now you're meeting again.
Oh, excellent. Thank you all for coming. So we also will elect a vice chair at this point. So open the floor to nominations for vice chair. I'll nominate John Hensman.
I'll second that nomination.
All in favor of Mr. Hensman?
Aye.
Aye. It's unanimous. Okay.
I second that.
We've got election of officers. Minutes, I think we saw a long time ago.
They did come out in time.
Yeah.
So that was for our March meeting.
Yeah.
So entertain a motion to approve those minutes.
Second.
All in favor of approving the minutes for March?
Aye.
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 Thank you very much. There is no correspondence. I checked the planning room. There is nothing in there. So first up, we have Dan Pepin, 160 Summersworth Road. I don't think that's your address, is it? So if you want to come and have a seat and tell us what's on your mind.
Should I come too?
Oh, we're missing a table tonight. Sorry about that.
Yes.
I'm from Kevin McAmini's office, and we're going to be doing application for Dan Pepin, and my name is Cheryl Andreessen.
Oh.
Cheryl, I'm sorry, can you spell your last name for me?
A-N-D-R-E-A-S-O-N.
I'm sorry, what was the address again?
It's 224 Summersworth Road.
Thank you.
All right, why don't you share with us what you have in mind? I have no idea what you're...
So Dan came to us because he needs to have, he was told he needed a site plan to be submitted for his new business, or I guess, I don't know if it's new, but...
Yeah, no, we've been there for a little bit, for a few years now, since we put the building up. But basically what was going on was, I had been working with Brian at 224 Summersworth Road, working on his stuff, and then it a little bit led to a little bit more outside work and not just on his stuff. So basically what I was trying to do is go try to get my New Hampshire State Inspection License for vehicles. And so I've submitted all my paperwork for the state, and I thought I had everything set with the town, but apparently not. So we're just trying to figure out
okay.
What else I need.
Who told you you needed a site plan? Tom Clark?
Well, Caroline advised me that I needed one, also Tom, and then, but my, I thought we had already done this, me and Brian, 3 or 4 years ago when we were putting the building up.
What is Brian's last name?
Turgeon. regulations of our time and things of being there. So I'm trying to get approvals for the, well, the state's trying to get approvals to the town to come and certify the shop and myself and things, but apparently they haven't because there's some kind of conflict that.
I think the form, the inspection station form has to be sent to the town and then there's a box, do you comply with zoning?
Right, and that's what happened, and that's what flagged the whole thing.
Yeah, and that happens all the time.
So basically, we're just here to kind of, tonight, to figure out what, to what extent does this site plan need to be in order to show compliance for what he's doing?
What was approved there, what was approved there before? I don't remember.
It's a second business. My understanding is you have a sec, there's a, you are operating a second business on a property that Brian Turgeon is already operating a business on.
Correct.
So I don't know the status of that first business, but there was no record on file of this business, which is at the same location going through.
So Brian has an approval to do what was it, equipment storage, that was it?
It's okay.
Yeah.
Heavy equipment storage?
Yeah.
For his, he's an excavator?
He's an excavator, correct.
Okay, and your business is repairing cars?
Yes.
Okay.
I started with Brian's stuff and then it just led to a little bit more.
Yeah, I think Carolyn's exactly right, it's a second business on the lot, so you, I mean, I think, I would just, it should be, Kevin should know that, just, I would go right through the site plan review checklist and you're gonna need everything, boundaries, where parking is, where the, where.
Does it have to be designated parking or like a full?
Knowing, I would say, yeah, I mean, yeah, I would say, I mean, I'm only the board's, hired planner, but I can tell you that we've had ongoing issues with businesses where we don't know exactly where things are parked. So, yes, I mean, you can ask them, but.
And this is a proper use in that zone, it is.
I don't even know where it is, so.
It does feel like.
Yeah, and I think that that's an approved use in that zone.
This is what was there before the building went up.
I know, if you're not looking, you're not looking at selling, you're not looking at selling vehicles.
You didn't do it.
Okay.
We did this site plan when we did it.
For Brian?
For Brian, several years ago, I have a few copies if anybody wants to.
Can't master in there, you should be able to see them, I believe.
So this was just done before the building went up, and we did a septic design and we did this site plan, it's basically existing conditions. And this was proposed site.
This is industrial.
To show where the septic was going.
Was, can you, is.
So this is some of.
Was everything done, everything on here, is it done? Is it, does this accurately reflect what's there now?
No, if we're going to update this, that's why I'm here to.
So, in other words, like the composite on the concrete pad, is that gone?
No, it's there.
No, it's there.
So a lot of the things that were part of this approval were never done?
A lot of this, well, I'd almost have to say that a lot of this on this plan is done.
Still current, except we're not showing where his new building is. And in fact, it does seem like we show, and we'll double check, but it seems we show like all of the gravelled area. That's all gravel area, and that looks like it still is that way.
Yeah.
And our field crew is going to confirm all that. Because this is 4 years old, so we will update it to show the conditions that are there today. But does it need to have a full in parking layout or designated in any way? I mean, it's just a gravel area.
Do you want me to speak?
Yes, certainly have for other applicants.
This is going to be nothing but a nightmare for this board, for the select board, and for everybody in the future if you don't. Yes, I think it needs to be designated where cars are going to be parked if they're, I mean, we're already looking at something that, this was, for instance, the condition, part of the approval was this thing was going to be removed. It's still there today, 4 years later.
What was in the unit?
Oh, this one, this.
The concrete.
Is that concrete that's still there?
Yeah, there was no discussion of that painting.
Well, it says right here to be ready.
Brian must have back then when we did this, must have indicated he was going to remove that.
No, there was a pile.
I'm only reading the plan that was approved, and it says the Quonset hut to be removed, there's a trailer park, a storage trailer park there that's to be removed.
I don't know that this is the exact approved one because it's not been signed or anything, but it was just a copy of what, it may have been a working plan.
Yeah, there was really, that we know, there was no discussion of removing that.
It may not have been a discussion, but maybe he said, well, I'm gonna remove it, but it, you know, it.
He must have indicated we wouldn't have put that in there at one time, maybe he considered moving it when we put that there. So I'll have to get, we'll have to talk with Brian.
I think that site review is gonna, if you're asking if it's gonna be necessary, and I would think a thorough one would be because of the, you know, you've got different traffic patterns now and different amount of vehicles that'll be there. You've got to account for employees now. I mean, it's a different use of business. Not, you know, between the business and you and the owner have, that's your business and that's not a problem. I just think that, you know, because we're gonna need to look at traffic as well. And you know, that is a gravel area still currently, you know, so that's gonna want to be reviewed as well. The access road.
I mean, I don't think that this board is going to require a full-blown drainage analysis because everything is there. I'm assuming you're going to put a building somewhere on the gravel. Are you going to build in a building?
No.
No.
Okay.
It's just using the building that's there.
Then I think everything just needs to be sort of delineated on the plan, where cars are going to be parked. You know, if you're having people off the street come there, I would assume, I mean, are you going to do out any kind of lighting?
That's what I was going to ask you about.
I mean,
How much lighting?
Well,
I mean, in your hour, you know, are you?
In the winter, if someone's picking up a car at 5 o'clock, I'm assuming you're going to need lighting in the parking lot.
We got a door light on the building.
Yeah. How about at the street?
Hours of business. Have you had any thoughts on that, as far as open business hours?
Yeah. Like 8 to 5.
And weekends.
Saturdays, maybe 7 p.m.
And you're not committed to that right now, I understand.
Yeah.
I think that those are things you're going to need to address. Is there going to be additional signage up front?
We've already had put a sign up.
There is a sign.
Yeah.
So it's a
waste. How long have you been operating this business?
I've been working out of there since the building's up, 3 years? 2 years?
You've been operating a business out of there for 3 years?
He was working on just the owner's equipment.
Yeah, you came before
lot.
Like six, 8 months ago.
And he takes care of his equipment, and he has a full operating shop
that
he wants to do.
You said you wanted to put out a sign at that point.
I understand your question.
You weren't changing what you were doing there. You wanted to put out a sign. I think the difference now is that this is an inspection station.
Right. So you were only doing Mr. Turgeon's vehicles?
Yeah.
You're not doing anyone else's right now?
Right now I've expanded, yes. So I'm doing people on the street.
Okay.
And the sign is up.
Yes.
Is there a permit for that?
I think that's the guidance we gave.
So there is a permit for the sign.
Just to be fair.
So I guess what I would suggest that, you know, you do is, because the public is going to be on the site versus just Turgeon's equipment, you know, I think you ought to have, you know, the driveway shown, and it's sort of, I guess, sort of loosely shown, you know, exactly where the driveway
is,
where customers are going to park. You know, you really need at least a handicap space to comply with the ADA. And it's not just us sort of telling you that, but if someone is in a wheelchair and they can't get to your building, they're going to sue you and you're going to have a problem. So it makes sense just to, you know, and again, you know, you only need one space probably, but it probably, I think it's going to need to be paved, you know. Well, you need to look it up in the ADA. Yeah. I mean, I think the other spaces you can get away with gravel. I mean, you know, someone needs to be able to reasonably wheel a wheelchair or a walker.
Would that be in the site?
Well, I think, well, I, our site plan review regs will tell you what you have to have for parking.
Right.
But in terms of the surface for, I'm pretty sure we require parking areas be paved. I think we probably granted you a waiver before. I don't know if the board would grant one again. It's up to them. But that one, the ADA space is going to be, that's probably the one that would absolutely need to be, I think. You need to look it up.
I do say that when this approval is granted on this piece of property, there's no discussion of an open to the public repair shop.
Right, it was an open shop for somebody running the.
It was only for your house. Now you've got, you know, you've got business, you know, now you've got regular customers. And yes, it's an approved plan as a representative area, but I mean, to think that you, and I know, you know, you're going through the right path, and I understand that. But to piggyback another business into a site plan that's been approved based on a different use, I think it dissolves, you know, requires a pretty thorough look and discussion.
Sure, was the septic system put in and all, that's all done?
That's all done.
The septic system for the employees and the.
Well, this is for the shop.
For the shop.
But now we have a business running there, so I don't know if there's different criteria for.
That's something, well, I don't know, but that's something that Tom would need to answer. I don't know, like, I don't know if they need to have a public restroom or not. I don't know if it needs to be ADA compliant. I don't know what automobile.
See, that's what makes me think that it's, you know, a little more involved.
So again, that's a question for Tom Clark.
Well, I doubt.
I think it's a little more involved in the plan that's.
I don't know. I don't know what the law, I don't know what the law is. So that's, again, that'd be a building code question for Tom. But in terms of the site plan, I think, you know, we're going to want to know where the parking's going to be for the public, where cars are going to be stored, exactly where they're going to be stored. And I think the board's going to want to see striping. And again, it's probably not going to be there in the field in reality. But we've had, you know, with Paul, we had issues with him and we made him comply. And now I believe he's.
It's a bigger business.
It's, well, but we don't know what this is going to be in 2 years. You
true.
Know, you bring out another mechanic and all of a sudden there's 15 cars sitting there.
That's true.
So,
but based on the square footage of the, you have two bays that are for you to use?
One.
Or just the one?
Yeah.
Is yours?
Yeah.
So
you're not the owner of the property, right?
No.
Okay.
So you use one bay in your, so it will only be you. If there's only one bay, you can't be another employee, but I guess if you're not there, somebody else would be there and still be, but.
Well, no.
So if
possibly,
he,
yeah, but it
if he was to expand, like, and get one employee, come back to the town.
No, I think if it's again, we're gonna let us see a picture of a representation of what this building looks like. Because it's been so long. If there's two bays and you're saying you're using one bay, I think what Kevin said is I'm gonna want to know what the hours of operation are.
Yeah.
If you want to have a part time employee working on cars, that doesn't. I don't think it affects. I don't think this board cares. So no, you wouldn't have to come back. But if you started working two shifts,
mm-hmm.
if you tell us you're working eight, you know, 7 to 5, and all of a sudden
yeah.
you're working. You know, 7 to 11. I think that could be a problem. So just give us some thought. You know.
Yeah. Yeah.
But no, adding an employee won't. I don't think we're changing it.
One space for each employee.
I mean, you clearly have a seat.
Four space. I mean, yeah, it's tons of space. It's just a matter of
just
how
showing where
easy.
Our cars are going to be parked. Yeah.
Yeah. And then with Tommy Clark, you want to answer the question about whether any portion of that should be paid?
If he's willing to. Again, I just don't know. I'm not an ADA expert. You know, most of the commercial spaces, or most of the commercial parking areas that we deal with are paved. So
if he was able, like, just to put like an apron up, the front of the building,
no problem.
Just leave it
as long
at
as
that.
It's accessible into the building. You know,
right.
Sure.
So it's all flat and
yeah.
easy to get in there.
I mean, clearly that would be fine. I just don't know if gravel does. I don't know.
Right. Okay. And then the lighting. I want to see some additional lighting.
Well, again, again, even if this board doesn't care about lighting, and again, I'm not saying they don't, I think they do. At 5 o'clock on a Friday night in the middle of the winter, someone comes in there, falls in your parking lot, who do you think is gonna get sued? It's gonna be you. So I would think you'd wanna light your parking area. And you know, we don't want.
It doesn't have to be the whole, this is like a really
just where people are parking. Right, where people are parking.
So just right around the building.
Yeah, so they can be safe and they can, you know, see where they're walking, that's all. And it may be one light on the building, that may be enough. I don't, again, I don't know how you're gonna lay it out.
Right.
So, would it be safe to say though, we could get waivers for like a traffic impact study? Things like that, drainage analysis, all of those kinds of things, or?
When you say safe to say,
Because if we were to submit an application.
If Mr. Turgeon, the property owner, is all on board with this, absolutely. Because it impacts, you know, his property as well.
Right.
As a landlord.
I mean, if you have.
He'll be notified too, but I wonder, it, there's not really a place, I have him signing it as the applicant, but.
We'll need a letter of authorization from the church.
Okay, alright.
But, you know, if you have one bay and even two mechanics, what are you gonna be generating, 3 or 4 cars a day? So I think it's a reasonable thing to say you wouldn't need a traffic study. And again, in terms of drainage analysis, everything is there now, so I don't know what, I don't think that, at least from my perspective, I don't see what the point of that would be. But I don't know what you're proposing to make, what change you're proposing to make. And I don't know if this was built, you know, we already know there's some things that weren't done.
It's like a large gravel area with a large two bay building on it.
Yep.
And that's it, it's all wide open and there's really nothing.
Does your bay, can it accommodate more than, work on more than one car at a time? It's a pretty big building, is there a cold to be?
Yeah, it's a big building. It's 40 by 40, put it down the front. Yeah.
So you have more than one lift in there maybe?
No, I don't.
Okay, alright. And you anticipate storing vehicles outside? You know, we've had issues before with, you know, vehicles being stored and the time of length that vehicles can be stored outside and where to park them. But I'm not trying to hold you anything, I'm just asking if that's something you see.
There should be an area where you can keep your vehicles that you're kind of jogging around.
And again, we're going back to Paul's, one of the issues we had was, you know, people would come to him with a 10-year, 15-year-old car that needed $3,000 worth of repairs and it would sit there for 2 years.
Yeah.
And we had nothing but complaints about stuff like that. So I can't remember what we restricted him to, but
they need to be registered.
Everything had to be registered.
Required to be registered.
And if a customer couldn't pay, then we wanted to tow it out of there. Because we didn't want it turning into a junkyard.
Right. No, neither
of us. Right. And that's the kind of thing that I would assume this board is going to be concerned about with you, just like we were with Paul. It's pretty reasonable stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is there any intent to sell vehicles there also or not?
No.
No?
No, no.
Okay. Well, I'm just asking that.
Are we allowed other applicants to sell it to such two cars?
Well, and again, I wouldn't say no. I would say, you know, if you bring in a car and someone can't pay, you want to sell it, that's, you know, if you sell 2 or 3 cars a year, it might be different, you know. So just, you need to think about what you want to do before you come to us.
Because it sits off the road quite a ways, no like buffers or landscape buffers or screening or anything that's necessary.
Those were probably addressed, right?
I think he's got a good amount, like I think he's
It's an industrial use, it's back industrial. Off the road. It's like, naturally wooded on other properties.
All around the outside edge of it is vegetated. I think these are a row of trees. Is this
a rock
tree? Oh, those are rocks. Yeah. Okay.
It says right there, Cheryl, a row of large stones.
Oh, I see that. All right. Gotcha. That is still probably 4 years. So. So, questions I have
Would this fall under as a minor review or a full review? Kind of like trying to, because it affects the fee as well.
I would think minor. I believe it's
repair shop going on there now.
Yeah.
I understand it's not a public repair shop.
Yeah.
I would say minor.
Yeah, he's fine.
I got the most recent. This is 2007. So
I don't think much has changed, but you can pick up the new, you can buy the new one, so you should have it.
Okay, I think I've got a good grasp on what you guys want to see.
Perfect. All right. Well, thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You guys don't want those, I'll take them.
I'll keep it.
Okay, you can keep it.
I'm so good enough for those things I see in my car. What's that?
I got enough site plans in the back seat of my car.
Yeah. John for the Walter Firestar. So, okay, I guess that's it.
Right.
Thank you
very much. Alright, next up we have Paul Turner, 427 Silver Street. Here to talk to us about minor subdivisions. Yeah. It's a fun sit at the table.
Sorry.
Just bring your own chair. No, normally they're already set up. It's just not set up right tonight.
So you're here to figure out if you need a waiver for
yes.
a pork chop. So yeah, and John, I don't know if you had a chance to look at
it. Yeah, Jeff Oliva sent it to me, and I wanted to defer to Tom just because this is a tough one. I don't agree with Tom, but I don't think they have the correct lot area. And again, I think a variance. I suggest that they just use a variance, but. Tom has taken the position that with you have sewer, or you have water.
I have city water.
And no sewer.
And a septic.
And a septic. Yeah.
But that Dunning test on it, they said it's more than that. But, I mean.
Oh, I'm sure it is, yeah.
So what is your concern, John?
Well, the minimum lot, what's the minimum lot size? No,
15,000.
15,000. Yeah, so they're okay, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So why is Jeff doing this?
I believe frontage.
The 100 feet?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Oh. So that does that cut into the current driveway?
No.
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 Setbacks, it looks like it's kind of there.
Yeah. Well, he shows 100 feet in the footage. If you can read it. I have to get off the magnifying.
I can read it.
That's what I'm trying to entertain right now. So.
Right here.
Yeah, so that is that an issue then?
Well, it's odd.
Yeah, I mean it's.
I mean the reality is you can't really. I mean you could put an easement over this. I mean this is where zoning just sort of stinks. There's no other place to. I've never seen this house. Is this your dad's house?
No, it's my
house.
It was my grandparents.
Okay, so where's the, is this? I would assume this is a front load garage.
It is a front load garage.
So this driver's not going anywhere. That driver. Okay.
Can I just?
You were in before. You wanted to put a family member in the back.
I want to live in the back. I want to put a family member
in the front. Okay. I knew it was something like that. Yeah. Okay.
So I guess the only thing you can, I mean, this driveway's not going anywhere. It's going to have to be on the back lot. And you know, the only thing you'd have to do is put some sort of easement, which is sort of odd, you know, like that.
You know what I mean? When he comes to you, he'll own both parcels. So he certainly grant the easement.
Well, I think you'd want the easement on the plan. Just
to show, yes, to show. Yes.
And
yes.
I know you're not selling it now, but yes. It's just, you know.
I plan on leaving it to my kids someday.
You would, but this is all we want, some sort of an easement there to allow that driveway to remain, you know, and again, it's a simple thing to do.
But that doesn't prohibit you from selling at any point. No. Just the new buyer would have to know that,
it's on the deed.
You know, for paper purposes, someone's driving over the corner of his lot in his driveway.
Sure.
And that would be, in perpetuity, so.
Now, what do you mean by there? There has to be a structure there, bushes, something?
No. All of this is just a legal instrument, basically
recorded
saying
permission
that this person, that this guy has the right to have a driveway on this lot.
Okay.
That's it.
So I would be giving myself that?
Yeah. I know it sounds stupid, but again, you know,
but you'd want
tomorrow
when
you sell it, like, you know.
Yeah.
Okay.
But if you sell it, the new buyer would have to understand that he owns land that's underneath his neighbor's driveway. But the neighbor can only drive across it. He can't put a fence there. He
the
can't.
Driveway, I mean, you still wouldn't be, it's still, according
it shows
to the
it's a paved driveway.
It's
yeah.
a paved driveway, and then I believe it.
See, here's the problem. This is the lawn and the jet we're showing right there.
Mm-hmm.
So the driveway is on the back lot.
No, it's actually right here.
Right. It's all the way over to the side.
Come over here, look at
that. It's like the paved driveway.
This is what Jeff is showing as the driveway right here. There's one side, and there's the other. You live there.
This is our driveway.
Go measure
it
now.
Yeah, right.
In front of this garage, in front of this bed.
So the house is going to
be does. The car does come over.
Yeah.
It's just
the paper. Does the paper go to here?
Or not? It does go to there.
Yeah, so pull the big one out, so you know what it's going to see. Is this, do you mind?
Yeah, right here.
See, he's got, yeah. See, right here, he's got edge of pavement. This is the edge of the pavement right
okay.
here.
Okay.
That's the problem.
Right.
This is no problem.
Not a big deal at all.
It's no big deal at all.
Just curiosity.
Yeah, so it looks like this whole area is paved, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So it's just, all you gotta do is, you know, draw something, a line like that, and then just have an access even, you know. Just like that.
Okay.
Simple. You know. Always going to show the plan.
All right, big deal at all.
It's a good thing for you to have, because like I said, if something ever happened to your soul, you'd be protected or whoever lived in the valley. Yeah.
Right.
So, not a big deal.
So, John, that's as simple as just changing on the plan, and when it gets registered at the Registry of Deeds, then you'll be covered.
Okay.
So you don't have to. It's not a big, huge hoop to jump through.
No.
Okay. Or, you know, you don't want to sell it, but, you know, the kids maybe someday too, you know, you never know. So.
Yep.
And they might be a lot, so we're sort of buying them a lot. So.
Okay.
We'll have to tear it up.
Or tear it up. Okay. So, it sounds nutty.
All right.
So, yeah, I don't think that there's a waiver to be.
Well, so the zoning ordinance specifically says we don't allow
pork
chop. So
that's
the question.
There is, then, right?
It's
pretty clear.
Yeah, I don't know what it is. But Tom's question was, what's the definition of a pork chop?
Well, maybe the extra little handle disqualifies it from being a pork chop. I don't know. To me, this is certainly a better, more logical way of doing this than when you really wanted a right with the underground.
Well, I was hoping to get away with that.
Right, but I mean something like that you have to do, right? Yeah. This is cleaner, so it's just minor.
I think everybody's on the same page. Just trying to get you there.
bear with us.
I don't have my subdivision. But here's the thing, here's the snag. It's 100 feet of frontage, so he's got that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So he meets the frontage, so.
So what is the definition?
I think that's the question. What's the definition?
Oh, we probably don't define it. There's no definition. But if it had, I mean, typically a pork chop lot would be, you know, 30 or 40 feet of
frontage. Right. At least so got for a driveway.
You're right, he's got the frontage. I mean, it's a little bit, I mean, it's, I think we can all say it's a little fun, but they've got the frontage. So I guess I would say, I mean, I would, and I think Tom has taken the same position, that it's not a pork chop. You know, if it went back something like this, with 50 feet, that would be different. You know, he's got legit frontage, so.
So, I just want to pose a question. There's a proposed second driveway for the rear lot that would require going to the state for approval.
Yep.
The state has rules about whether extra driveway, like whether or not you get a driveway, let alone how many, you know. So I'm not sure that they would necessarily approve that, and I don't mean to say they wouldn't.
Even if it's subdivided, I'm just.
No, because the Roberts Road, the new construction on Roberts Road, doesn't get a new driveway because they're going back to 1971 rules.
Oh, so they're going to share the driveway.
Right, so, he's
so you could share this driveway.
I mean, there's so many curb cuts there. I think we could leave it up to them that if they, you know, it would be awkward to tie this driveway into there and you'd, you know, you'd be going right by the front of this house. So I hear what Carolyn is saying. Probably the best result way to handle this would be to say, if you can't get that driveway, come back and see us. You know?
Right, because I don't know that we can approve it as.
Yeah.
So I got to try to get the driveway approved before subdividing.
It's not that. That's not that hard. You know, I don't know who the district engineer is, but.
It would be safer for you to make the application to the state first.
And it's cheap and easy, so, you know.
At least you have your path.
Yeah. That way, if we have to change it, you have to have one shared driveway.
I'm sure, and I think Jeff probably thought of that. You know, raised up with him. So I guess, if the board just, if you all decide that you have the, you're of the opinion that this is not a pork chop lot, then I would say they probably have the green light to proceed.
I'm not sure it's not a pork chop lot. I don't know, but I'm saying that, so the 42, you're adding 42 feet here, right? When you're going with this, you're getting 42 feet, right? So without it, you only have, is that what that means?
Yeah, 42 feet.
And then combined, you have 100 feet? Is that what that's saying at the front?
Correct.
And so without this 42, you only have 48 on that side, right?
Right.
Which would be less than the...
Less than 100 feet required.
Well, why would you
need... Chop lot, then, if you only had the 58 feet footage, and you'd be under on your frontage.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But this has the frontage. I think it's pork chop in shape only, not in definition.
Well, imagine if it was 300 acres and you had
right.
500 feet of frontage.
Yeah. Yeah.
It went way back. It was a 250 acre factor. Then it would be a hard
job. I'm not saying it is, I'm just saying I'm not sure it's not. I know a lot of voices and not.
Let's see if the state actually does. We'll get ourselves in trouble.
Does anyone know where the pork chop language came from?
It's sort of an old school word. I mean, most towns call it backlot, but
right.
It looks like a pork chop. No.
See,
the state defines
it
as like backlot.
Yeah, I doubt it.
There's no pork chop in the state.
Stratum, like subdivision regulations.
A definition. Do you have it right there?
Yeah.
Could you read it?
Yeah. So their definition is a subdivision of one lot divided into two where insufficient frontage would normally result, so long as the lot to be divided has an existing single-family dwelling in front of this. One lot must have a minimum of 200-foot frontage. The other lot shall have a minimum of 50-foot frontage on it.
So either way, I'd be okay.
Because
yeah.
He has frontage.
If you're strictly looking straight on
the front. Thank you, Charles. But
that's the
that might be based on the
No, it's not. And a lot of towns, you know, allow, like in a new subdivision, they'll allow one or two back lots.
I don't think frontage is part of the lot, so.
Yeah.
Okay, I missed that one. I'm going to check that.
I don't think so.
Yeah, I tend to agree. I don't think that the pork chop.
I would go along with that too, but I think.
But I would think he's going
really
to make applications to the state first, and that gives us time to research this further.
You might have to spend more money than to redesign your plans to move the driveway when you could have just gotten it all done before you came in and gave a formal application to it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, okay. So people always want to go into this. Or go time.
Creative use of the lot.
So stop the end, and now my only dilemma is that not only needs once a month, if I can indeed get this application to the driveway, I'm going to still ask them back here again.
Well, you haven't even made an application.
You haven't made an application. So
yeah,
let me know.
I mean, you got to file an application, you got to give us, I can't remember how many plans, you pay your fees. I don't know when the deadline is, but this is what I would do. If you're in a hurry, I would talk to Jeff Oliva and say, listen, I want to submit my application for the June meeting. Let's see if we can get that driveway permit, as long as he's confident that he can get it before the June meeting. Because we're going to make it a condition of the approval, and if you don't have it, then you have to go back to us anyway. So, I just don't know what the backlog is with the state right now. You know, I don't know if they're running two, but Jeff will know that. He does this stuff all the time. All
right.
You know, if he says they're 6 weeks out, then he might say, let's wait till July, you know?
Yeah.
So I would say talk to him, and DES right now is running 3 or 4 days for a septic approval.
Right.
It used to be they were 6-7 weeks, so I don't know what they are.
All right.
So talk to them.
You think to apply for that first.
Right. Well, it's a good point.
The cutoff for June is actually May 16th.
Excuse me, I'm sorry.
The cutoff for for June is May 16th. So if you want to be on the June agenda.
Which I think is next Wednesday.
That's
don't say that. You never. I mean, he looks like he's got the plan almost done, but you can ask him.
Okay. Alright. And we only have those standards that we have to send out to all the butters and all that. Not that we don't want to get it done for you. We have to give notice to everybody else who lives around. You have to have a certain amount of time to do that.
I will say, since you guys have been here at least a few times, and I've talked to Jeff, I think that it's a simple, relatively simple subdivision. Unless something comes up that none of us have thought of, I don't anticipate this is going to take. It's going to be a one meeting approval. So, you know, in worst case, you can't get it in for June,
mm-hmm.
or you can't get the driveway permit for June, and you're back in July. I would venture a guess that you're going to walk away with approval the night you bring it in. So,
okay.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
Have a good evening. You too.
Back to our agenda. adjournment is the next thing on the agenda, but I did want to take a moment and welcome our newest member, Caroline Kendall, which she was in the other room when we called the meeting with order, so welcome. Pleased to have you.
And everyone got their blue book, I should have passed on. I apologize, but I came to see the journal tonight. For the next meeting, can we put on the agenda to have a discussion about what ordinance changes may need to be made this year. I think during our training, there were a number of suggestions that were made that we really should be following, or in fact, we should be following. Just around investment of subdivisions, or who and how these plats are recorded or registered.
Well, the other thing that came up tonight, which is pretty interesting, is, you know, is the fact that we have an approved site plan that obviously the building's being used, that a lot of stuff wasn't done.
Yeah.
And you know, I don't know how. Again, this isn't Dover, where there's a big staff, and you know, when they go to get a certificate of occupancy in this building, you know, someone would go out and make sure that everything was done. But this can't happen, because otherwise we're just sitting there wasting our time.
We don't know if that's the final plan
of
this, but
we don't. So yeah, I mean, things could have changed.
Quite taken, and I think the problem is not so much staff and resources, although that's always a problem. I think it's just process. Something's approved, and we've had a communication gap, and then we could ask. They got a building permit to build a new building once upon a time. Once upon a time, the building that he's operating.
Oh, sure, yeah.
You know, if that building permit came out of this plan, if there was some communication and we need to document a process, then he could make sure as part of that inspection that he's removing or, you know, checking conditions and things like that. But we don't have a communication flow.
Do we know where you're building?
Well, this was approved, we don't know when it was approved. It was last revised in December of 14, so 4 years before, that was over 4 years ago. No, it wasn't. 3 years ago.
Well, kind of also to that end, Caroline and I were briefly discussing, because somebody asked me about, actually it was Cheryl who asked me about some middle requirements. Currently we're asking for 6 full sets of plans every time they come before the board. And at this point we're drowning in plans that we don't know whether they're the final plan, what revision. So maybe we might want to, if we're going to have a public hearing for some other things, maybe we can also at that hearing maybe talk about some changes in submittal needed or requirements. Any fee changes we want to make this year. I still haven't talked to Stephanie over at Radigan's, but
we
need to do that. But rather than like have a whole separate, because we need to publicly notice that.
Yeah.
Maybe we could like put all into one thing.
So we're currently filing though now the final approved signed off plan.
We took that back.
Well,
there's a period of time that we allowed. That we require the applicant to do.
I don't think anything is going to happen.
Let me back up. We're not filing a registry. We're holding a copy here that goes along with keeping a file, then a building permit, all the stuff that's associated with that parcel. We started that.
Well, separately, we have property parcel files in the office that have tax assessment cards and building permits.
Okay.
Planning files are separate in the other room, which don't typically have copies of building permits, even if they're associated with a plan. So it's minutes and plans, but the short answer is no, it's a mess.
I mean, in some of the files for approvals that we've done in here, like I've created the files for them, and so they had like conditional letters that needed, so those should probably be with your files rather than
yes.
Okay, so it's a much larger conversation.
It's a huge conversation.
But that doesn't really address the policing issue of making sure that things that are prior to
be
done.
We have a lot of issues.
Maybe if it was more, if there was more of a process, it would be easier to police it.
Yeah.
culpability to her.
So how did, when recently a landowner got a conditional approval and we went to get a building permit and were denied, I don't want to use the name, how did they know?
She and I have an information flow.
Okay.
And it's informal. And when one of us leaves, it's going to die.
No one's leaving.
So we need to have, a more formal process.
Yes.
Yep. Because you're right, like someone...
For as long as that works, it works. But if one of us is sick and out for 2 weeks, we might forget there was a meeting that we need to talk about.
Yep. And then the other thing is, you know, I don't think this board has ever spoken with Tom.
No.
But it might be good to have him in, with, you know, at a night when Mike is here. Just to make sure we all understand that, that when something like this gets approved, if Tom says, it's not my responsibility or I don't want to do it, then someone else is going to need to step up and do it, whether it's me or you or somebody on the board, just to make sure everything that we approved is done. We started, because I think a lot of stuff we take at face value that people are going to do, and
right.
I've always
clearly,
assumed.
This is the final plan, and that's one of us, so Sam.
And I just remember with some of the jailer stuff, things never really got done, but... maybe they did eventually, but I think it wouldn't be a bad idea just to have them in here and say, how is this work? Is this working for you? And if it's not, maybe we should find a better system. We need to come up with a better system.
Yep.
So, you know, whenever he's available, it might not be a bad idea.
I like the sound of it. Anything else? I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second? Second. All in favor?
Aye.
We're June 3rd, but it's actually June 5th. June 3rd is a Sunday.
Yeah. Oops.
So see everyone in 4 weeks.